Hi, my name is Karen Thompson. Sharon Kowalski and I were in a committed relationship. We had exchanged rings. We considered ourselves married, and we'd lived together for 4 years. We bought a home outside of St. Cloud on Briggs Lake. We thought as long as we kept our personal lives separate from our professional lives, we'd be safe. We didn't understand that as long as we're invisible, we're vulnerable. Sharon looked at me and said, "Save Monday night for me. We haven't had much time together this weekend." And for us, Monday night never came, as she was hit by a drunk driver later that afternoon and sustained a traumatic brain injury. When I arrived at the hospital following Sharon's accident, I spent over 2 hours trying to find out if Sharon was dead or alive. And no one would talk with me because I wasn't family. I spent hours stretching out Sharon's fingers, her hands, her legs, her feet, her toes, in hopes that as Sharon came out of the coma, she'd regain use of some parts of her body. One evening, I was taken out of Sharon's room and told that no one could love Sharon like family loved Sharon, that family could meet all of Sharon's needs, and if I didn't cease visiting so often, they'd see to it that I couldn't visit at all. Following that, I started to ask some questions, like what are Sharon's and my rights as a couple? And of course, I found we have none. What then are Sharon's rights? Sharon's rights to see who she wants to see, to live where she wants to live, to get the best possible medical care. And I discovered that the only way I could have input into Sharon's rights was to file for guardianship. So I entered into a guardianship struggle with Sharon's biological family, not because I wanted to, but because I felt forced to. They were going to separate us. In July of 1985, the courts reached one ruling and found that Donald Kowalski should be appointed guardian. The judge wanted to remove the conflict between Sharon's family and myself, and he thought to do that, then he had to give one party full power. He gave full power then to the father who had said on the stand that there was nothing that could ever make him believe I was a loved one of Sharon's, and that he would do everything in his power to separate us. Within 24 hours of that court ruling, he ordered I should never be allowed to see Sharon again. And not only me, but all of Sharon's friends and support system from some 6 years of her life prior to the accident went down with me, guilty by association. A Minnesota Civil Liberties Union was now no longer allowed in to see Sharon. Disability rights groups who become involved in the case were no longer allowed in to see Sharon. Within 48 hours, he moved her from the court-approved facility to a nursing home in Hibbing, Minnesota that over a year before the courts had found didn't have the appropriate facilities for Sharon. He took a human being, an adult, and placed her in a nursing home against her will, didn't allow her to see the people she wanted to see. I compared this to a kidnapping. I didn't believe that this could happen here in the United States. I believed in truth, in justice. For over 3.5 years, I was not allowed to see Sharon. And during that period of time, when we snuck a person in to see her, they asked her, "Do you understand why Karen's not here?" Sharon said, "No." And when they explained it to Sharon, she typed, "I thought she left me." So for 3.5 years, I cried myself to sleep every night, seeing the love and the trust in Sharon's eyes from that last time I was with her before we were separated, when she typed out, "Help me. Get me out of here. Take me home." And I couldn't make it happen. Many times I left St. Cloud State for my teaching on Thursday and would fly to Washington, D.C., and I'd do programs there. And then I would fly to San Francisco and do programs there. So in the course of a weekend, I might have done 8 or 9 speaking engagements. And then I'd be back teaching again on Monday morning as if nothing had ever happened. And no one there would even know I'd been gone. I can't even begin to tell you how lonely it was, because as I walked down the halls of Hallenbeck Hall, where I taught, nobody talked to me. People go to the other side of the hall to avoid being seen with me. Hallenbeck was probably one of the most homophobic places on campus. Julie and Marianne would sit helplessly by, willing to do anything they could. Once when Julie pushed me hard to express my feelings, I couldn't keep myself from crying out. "I can't let myself tell you about the feelings because I'm afraid I won't be able to pull myself together again. I exist. I live. I wish away days and weeks until Sharon can come home. 4 years of wishing my life away." Marriage is extremely important. If I had been considered Sharon's spouse the night of the accident, I would have gotten in immediately to see Sharon. I would have had immediate input into Sharon's care. Sharon would have been allowed to come home a few months later. But I wasn't considered Sharon's spouse. Marriage is necessary to validate our families. We need the same rights, protections, privileges that other families have. Vote no on the Minnesota amendment in November. But marriage really isn't enough. Please protect yourselves from nightmares like Sharon's and mine, Tom and Shane's, Terry Schiavo's. Take control. Do your advanced care planning. We must build a record of what we would want if something like this were to happen. Document. Through durable powers of attorney, living wills, partnership agreements. In Minnesota, we have the Minnesota Healthcare Directive. It's so simple, just download it off the internet. It's completely free. We must protect ourselves, protect our relationships, protect our families.